Good morning. Let me give you a very warm welcome in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's good to see you here. It's good also to see those who are joining us online. Oh, I feel sorry for you because I can't see you, which I would like to, but you can see me. I have some sympathy with that. Paul writes these words of praise. Do come, find yourself a seat. Welcome. Paul writes these great words, which, in a sense, express at least the better moments of our desires when we meet together. Now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. We're going to sing our first praise together. We're going to stand to sing. Don't be embarrassed if standing is a struggle for you. Feel free to remain seated. The rest of us will stand to sing God, Immortal, Invisible. If you stand on the first note of the piano, that would be great. Thank you.
Oh,
Let us pray. Lord, we have sought to sing your praise together. Lord, there is in our hearts a desire to do that. And we thank you for your grace that has put it there. But so often, Lord, we struggle truly to enter in and to follow and to be wholly engaged with what our voices say. And we've expressed to you, Lord, profound truth. So many of us here, it is true of us that wondrous beauty has won our heart. As your beloved Son came to our world and lived here, and we have records of what he did, what he said, and in some measure, these things declare to us wondrous beauty. And we thank you, Lord, that there is a sense that when we read them, our hearts do warm to him. And when we read your word and it declares to us why he came and what is achieved for us, Lord, we thank you for the response we find, but Lord, for grace to love you more. Grace to be more taken up with him, to be more wholehearted in living for him, more single-minded. Lord, how we need your grace. That is what he deserves. And Lord, in our sanity, in the moments when our minds are clearest and our hearts most engaged, then that is what we desire. Lord, we pray that we may see him again as we meet together this morning. To see the beauty of our Lord Jesus Christ. To see perfection in humanity. And yet so much more. May we, Lord, hear your word together this morning. As if we heard it from his very lips. Lord, as if a voice from heaven spoke. Lord, may we realize that when we dig into your word, when we read of the Savior, we read the very words concerning him that you would have us to believe. Embrace, that we might embrace him and love him and live for him. Lord, increase these desires in us. Bring them anew to some hearts or hearts this day, we pray. Lord, we long to see your kingdom extended, not with the passion that you have. Use feeble words and simple testimony. Lord, by your Spirit, open eyes and heart. We ask, Lord, for your presence. For, Lord, if you are not here, what value is in our gathering? And we pray, Lord, that you look upon us in all our failure and pity us. Come to us and break down our self-reliance and all our foolishness. And may your grace seem to us for what it is, astonishing. Your grace in the Lord Jesus Christ. And we thank you and we pray in his name. Amen. Amen. Immediately prior to the words of scripture with which we began, we read these words in 1 Timothy chapter 1. Paul declares, here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. of whom I am the worst. For that very reason, I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his immense patience as an example for those who would believe in him and receive eternal life. May the Lord give us grace to see the immense patience and wondrous compassion of the Saviour together this morning. We'll sing of that. My song is Love Unknown. And as many as are able to sing, my song is Love Unknown. The Saviour's love to me, love for the loveless shown, that they might lovely be. Stand to sing.
My God. Thank you, Beth.
Okay, there's room over here as well if you want to squeeze through and come sit over here. Yeah, because there's still more coming. There's a chair here as well. Good girl. Come and sit down. All right. Okay, is everybody comfortable? Awesome. Lots of you are. Fantastic. Right. Is Jesus just for Sunday? Do we only think about Jesus when you come to church?
No.
Jesus is for every day, all the time, each moment. We know that's the right answer, but is it really what happens in our lives? We need to learn how to think about Jesus all the time. And we don't just do it, we need to practice. And one way that we do that is to read the Bible every day. So you can ask your adults, what about Bible time today? But another way is to fix the Bible inside you and use your memory to remember about Jesus, what he's like. So we can use everyday things we do and we see to remind us to think about Jesus. So we're going to sing a song that you all know, Help Your Memory. And I need you to help me with this song, at least with your hands, maybe with your voices as well. So can you put your hands on your head? Do you know this song? It starts with your head. What could it be? Head, shoulders, knees and toes, knees and toes. Head, shoulders, knees and toes and eyes and ears and mouth and nose. Head, shoulders, knees and toes, knees and toes. Okay, so we're going to think about each part of the body, not all today. Going forward, and something about Jesus, because Jesus had a body like just like us, didn't he? He's like God's picture to us of what God is like. And he also shows us how to be and how to use our bodies. So what was the first word in the song? What did we touch first? What did we touch? A head. That's right. Now, what can you wear on your head? A hat. Now then, we know Jesus is the king. We've been learning about that, don't we? So what does a king put on his head? The king wear. What does the king wear? Let me see if I've got something to remind you in here. What's this? Oh, wow, that was a good big voice. What's this? A crown. Okay, now, what is a real crown made of? One that a king might want to wear. What sort of things it might be? Gold. Gold with maybe with jewels even. Yeah, it's the very best. And we know, don't we, that Jesus is the best and deserves all the gold crowns. We've talked about that. Now, did Jesus have a crown when he was on earth? He did, actually. But do you know what that crown was made of? Well, I've got something in my bag. Hang on a minute, but I don't want anybody to touch it. I'm going to put my gloves on, all right? I'm going to put my gloves on to get this thing out of my bag. You can look, but absolutely do not touch what I've got in my bag. All right, well, we'll see why in a minute. Okay, you might not know what it is, but I'm telling you, don't touch it. Right. Now then, what is on there? Do you know what those are, Rose? They are thorns. And why am I telling you not to touch these thorns? You would, I tell you, I have had these in my finger and they are absolutely horrible. They wouldn't be nice. Now, do you know, they might be what? They're very spiky and they're very hurty, yeah? Do you know Jesus had a crown made of these and he wore it? Do you think that would be a nice crown? Would that be a happy crown or a sad crown? It would be a very sad crown. So do you think Jesus was happy to wear that crown? Well, it did really, really hurt. But Jesus wanted to wear it. He was glad, in a way, to wear it. Why? Would you want a crown like that? Would you want a crown like that? No. Because Jesus was taking this crown and this pain and this hurt for someone else. He was taking it away from someone else. From us. Jesus wore that crown on his head and he suffered and he died because of sin, wasn't it? Because we don't love and obey God. And he was happy to do that for us. That's the kind of king we have. He took our pain. He was hurt for our wrongs. The punishment that we should have, he took it instead so we can be made better inside. We can be friends with God. So this week, sing the song, head, shoulders, knees and toes. Every time you think with your head, every time you maybe wash your hair, comb your hair, every time you put a hat on, every time you have a headache, think of Jesus and what he wore on his head for you, a crown of thorns, pain, taking away the sin for us. And then come back next week for another reminder of something that Jesus was like. Okay, well done.
Thank you, Beth. Whoever imagined in their folly that children's talks are only for children? I've known, I can think of one lady who came here who became a Christian as a result listening to children's talks. It's a long time ago, but I remember it vividly. And she's now in glory because she listened, found lots of other things that were said here difficult to understand. That was the preacher's fault. That was me in those days, mostly. But this lady, I remember talking to her about how she came to faith, and one of the things that really, really helped her was some things that were said in talks for children. God is kind. Right, now then, we're going to read the Word of God together, and Joe's going to come and read to us a long passage from Luke's Gospel, chapter 22. I'm very grateful. I am the cause why there's a long passage of scripture being read, and Joe's going to come and read it for us. Sorry, it's on page 1057, I think, in the church Bibles. Thank you.
So it's Luke 22, starting at verse 13. They left and found things just as Jesus had told them, so they prepared the Passover. When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table. And he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God. After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took bread, gave thanks and broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. But the hand of him who is going to betray me is with mine on the table. The Son of Man will go as it has been decreed, but woe to that man who betrays him. They began to question among themselves which of them it might be who would do this. A dispute arose among them as to which of them was considered to be greatest. Jesus said to them, the kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those who exercise authority over them call themselves benefactors. But you are not to be like that. Instead, the greatest among you should be like the youngest, and the one who rules like the one who serves. For who is greater, the one who is at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one who is at the table? But I am among you as one who serves. You are those who have stood by me in my trials. And I confer on you a kingdom, just as my father conferred one on me, so that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom and sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift all of you as wheat, but I have prayed for you, Simon, that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned back, strengthen your brothers. But he replied, Lord, I am ready to go with you to prison and to death. Jesus answered, I tell you, Peter, before the cock crows today, you will deny three times that you know me. Then Jesus asked them, when I sent you without purse, bag or sandals, did you lack anything? No, they answered. Nothing, they answered. He said to them, but now, if you have a purse, take it, and also a bag. And if you don't have a sword, sell your cloak and buy one. It is written, and he was numbered among the transgressors, and I tell you that this must be fulfilled in me. Yes, what is written about me is reaching its fulfillment. The disciples said, see, Lord, here are two swords. That's enough, he replied. Jesus went out as usual to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples followed him. On reaching the place, he said to them, pray that you will not fall into temptation. He withdrew about a stone's throw beyond them, knelt down and prayed. Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done. An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. And being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. When he rose from prayer and went back to the disciples, he found them asleep, exhausted from sorrow. Why are you sleeping? He asked them. Get up and pray, so that you will not fall into temptation.
Going to look at that passage of scripture in a moment. Before we do, we're going to stand to sing what is a prayer. Prepare our hearts, O God. We'll stand to sing.
Thank you. If you're going out at this point, youngsters, now's the time to leave us. Hope you have a good time. Learn plenty. Listen well. Friends, if you have a Bible with you, do turn with me, and I do commend the practice of having a Bible in front of you when preachers preach. Those who stand at the front, including me, don't always get everything right, and it's very important to make sure that what you hear is what God says in His Word. So if you have a Bible in front of you, turn with me, please, to Luke chapter 22, and we're looking at the whole of the passage that was read for us, verses 13 to 46. It's on page 1057, 1058 in the church Bibles, I believe. To say that Britain has been known, at least in the past, as a Christian country, it is perhaps surprising how little understanding there is of what Christianity is really all about. If you ask people, and maybe if I ask you that question, could you articulate for me simply and clearly what is the heart of the Christian message? Not only out there in society, but in churches, in places that profess Christ, you wouldn't find so many people who are able to do that. People don't seem to know what Christianity is really about. Well, if that's you, if you scratch your head a bit, and my sympathy, it's probably as much the fault of the church as it is of you. But there's a big clue. Let me give you a hint. There's a big clue in the name, isn't there? Christianity. The Christian faith is all about Jesus the Christ, Jesus the Messiah. So the most famous Christian in the New Testament is arguably the great preacher, the Apostle Paul. He was obsessed with the Lord Jesus Christ. So when he writes his letter to his friends in Philippi that we have in the New Testament, he begins by describing himself literally as a bond slave of Jesus Christ. Who are you, Paul? I am Christ's slave. Willingly, happily, contentedly, the slave of Christ. My life is about pleasing Him. A little bit later in the first chapter, he describes his life like this: for me to live is Christ. He is my whole preoccupation. He goes on to say, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. That's a pretty revolutionary thing to say, especially in somebody who is not desperately depressed. He wasn't. That's not why he was saying he wanted to die. It's gain for him. Why, Paul? Why do you speak those strange words? Because, he says, it means to be with Christ. And that's far better, to be in His very presence, to see Him, to be with Him, better than the greatest joys of this world. And if you ask Paul in that letter, what's important to you, Paul? He says, I want to know Christ. In fact, he goes so far as to say, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. Clearly, Jesus Christ is the very heart of his life. Ah, but he was a one-off. What about ordinary Christians? Well, Paul says that the same is true of them also. In that same letter to the Philippians, Paul says that These are the marks of those who are really the children, the people of God. We who are the circumcision, we are the God's real people. And he says there are three characteristics of them. We serve God by his Spirit. We worship him, not in our own wisdom or strength, but in utter dependence upon the Spirit of God. And we put no confidence in the flesh, he says. We have no confidence that we are good enough for God. But the other thing he says is that we boast. He's not just talking about we in some sort of royal plural. No, no, he's talking about we Christian. It is characteristic of us that we boast about Christ Jesus. In fact, Peter, in writing his first letter, goes so far as to describe people. He's writing to people, many of whom he wouldn't even know. And he says to them, they're followers of the Lord Jesus Christ. He says to them this, though you've not seen him, no, you didn't see him when he was living on this world, you love him, he says. He's absolutely confident of that. So the very essence of what it is to be a Christian, to love the real Jesus Christ. And he says, even though you do not see him, now you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. Thinking about him, believing in him, produces joy in the heart. He says, that is normal Christianity. All real, spiritually healthy Christians are obsessed with Jesus Christ and boast about him. Why? Well, this passage will show us why. It will help us to see there is nobody like Jesus. What did the preacher say this morning? There is nobody like Jesus. That's all I want to show you this morning. Why? Because that will help those of you who look on, who are not sure about this Christianity, to understand your intriguing Christian friends a bit more. And perhaps it will lead you even to want to join them in following the Lord Jesus. I think it would also help discourage Christians to regain joy and perspective and not to lose heart and hope, and so to resist temptations to drift any further. But it will help all his followers to remember the wonderful privilege of simply being a Christian, whatever the cost, and hopefully will lead us all to be more determined to live for him. So let me show you three things from Luke 22. First of all, Jesus is the only rescuer. Jesus is the only rescuer. That's highlighted at least in verses 13 to 20. You see, from the beginning, Jesus had an amazing variety of followers. But Luke 22 reminds us that they all have something very fundamentally in common, a common trait. What was that? What was that all his followers have in common? Well, I'll tell you what it is, and it's fairly sad news. It's that even the best of Jesus' followers are flawed and guilty people. And notice the tense. It's not what they were, it's what they are as his followers. There was a unique group of Jesus' followers in the upper room for this Passover meal. In what sense were they unique? Well, they were hand-picked. He calls them, or they're called here in verse 14, Jesus and his apostles. Those special men. They were hand-picked, and they had really hung in there. In contrast to many of the crowds, in verse 28, Jesus says to them, you are those who have stood by me in my trials. When many have left, you have not. These are the best of his followers. But for all that, they're far from perfect. They are incredibly insensitive. He tells them, verse 22, that one of them will betray him. In the blink of an eye, what are they talking about? Verse 24. Have a dispute about which of them was the greatest. I can do insensitivity. But insensitivity at that level would be a challenge to me, I'm glad to say. These men, they are the best, but they are flawed and guilty people. And they're slow to learn because they've had this discussion before. He's taught them before about what constitutes true greatness. And he commends them for sticking with him, which in many ways is no great achievement at all. Not only that, but when he gets to the garden, he tells them to pray and warns them they could be swallowed up by temptation. What are they doing? They're sleeping. They're all far from perfect. He knows their weaknesses when they don't not recognize themselves. Simon Peter, Lord, verse 33, he says, you know, I'm never going to deny you. He's going to deny him three times that very night before the night's out. They didn't know themselves. They were confident. They were all in danger. He has to say to Simon Peter, when you've turned round, strengthen your brothers because they're weak. They're all weak and they're all failures. Are we so very different? Not at all. Even the best of Jesus' followers are flawed, guilty people. Is there any hope? Yes, because these verses 13 to 20, says this. Jesus says this. Verses 19 and 20 says, I'm the answer to this great problem. I am the sacrifice for your sin. Do you notice what he says? He took bread, gave thanks and broke it and gave it to them saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Do it in remembrance of me. My body is given for you. And then notice verse 20. In the same way after the supper, he took the cup saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. That's strange language to us. His body given, his blood poured out. It's the language of sacrifice, animal sacrifice. All that crude blood shedding in the Old Testament, designed by God to shout, look, you deserve my judgment. Sin is a vile thing. To deal with it involves death and suffering. And Jesus is now saying, I am the one who fulfills all that. I have come. And his words imply substitution. I am giving myself for you in your place, bearing your punishment under the wrath of the living God. That's the image. It's the blood of the covenant. It is poured out, he says, for you. It's all part of God's great plan to rescue humanity. In fact, it's the very heart of it. And he says, I have come to do that. This is why it's all happening at Passover. Passover celebrated the deliverance of God's people from Egypt. 2 millennia earlier. And it was remembered by the eating of a lamb that was sacrificed. And it pointed back to the time when God delivered his people from Egypt, where the people killed a lamb and painted the blood on the doorposts of the land. And the angel of judgment came over, and wherever the door were painted with blood, the firstborn was spared. In every other home, the firstborn in Egypt died. Jesus is saying, all that is gloriously and finally and fully satisfied in me. And he knew, this passage tells us, he knew just what horrors that would cost him. Fast forward a few hours, you see him praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. And he is praying to be delivered from the horrors that lie in front of him. It's a cold spring night, and he is sweating buckets. Whoever sweats when it's cold like that? You shiver, you don't sweat. He sweats because of the horror that faces him. He is in emotional turmoil. He's frightened that he will die from the experience of simply looking ahead to what faces him. That's the horror that he will go through when he gets to Golgotha, except when he gets to Golgotha, it is worse than his worst imagining. So on the cross, he cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? But still he says, I am the answer. I am the sacrifice for your sin. And notice what he says here. He says, when you think of me in the days ahead, and there are so many different ways to think of me, I want you to think of me preeminently as the Savior who has dealt with the problem of your sin. Do this, he says, in remembrance of me. Eat the bread and drink the cup, these symbols of my death. What compassion is this? He's determined that our failings, our sins, shall not forever torment us. The fear, the understanding of what we've done. He wants his people, those who depend upon him, who trust him, to remember that he has dealt with that which would cut us off from God. He is the answer to our sin. He is the only rescuer. The only answer. You notice he says, the Son of Man goes as it is decreed. This is God's way. This is the way that God has said. Are we going to imagine that if there was any other way to rescue humanity than that God should take our nature in his Son and that he should suffer and die under judgment in our place? Of course, there is no other way. And when Jesus prays, according to Matthew's gospel in Gethsemane, he prays the second time, Lord, if there's no other way, let this cup be taken away. That is, not just from me, but from the people for whom I'm dying. Let me drink it. The only way. The only answer. It's the answer that you and I need. And the first great reason why there is nobody like Jesus is that he is the only rescuer. The second reason is that he is the best of masters. Jesus is the best of masters. That's clear in verses 21 to 30 especially. Of course, many people think, I don't need any master. I can get through life. I can cope with everything life throws at me without someone to lead me, guide me, explain life to me, help me, and tell me what to do. Perhaps you think like that. I'm afraid all I'm going to do is raise my eyebrows, look you in the eyes and say, really? Who are you trying to kid? Life will throw at you many things that will floor you, trouble you, unsettle you, confuse you. It's probably done so already, but you try and forget those things. Have you not found yourself confused about what to do? Confused and bewildered by the circumstances you face? Looking, wishing somebody could show you the way forward. Oh, but perhaps you're understandably cynical about serving anyone because of bitter experience. You've been let down enough times by other people to think very strongly before you follow other people's advice. Well, won't you even look at Jesus, the Lord and Master of Christians? They testify that he is the best of masters. And that's what we see here in this passage. Surely he is, for notice how patient he is in the face of incredible insensitivity and unkindness. They're disgusting. As he faces the horrors of Golgotha and his death, they're discussing which of them is the greatest. And what does he do? He patiently explains again that truly greatness is about service. In the kingdom of heaven, God considers those great who serve, whose hearts are about other people and their needs, not about their own. He says, that's what I've come to do. And I am the king of that kingdom. You follow me, follow my example. And then he explains to them in vivid picture language that life is going to get harder. Verses 35 to 38. Life is going to get harder. They used to be able to count on people if they went and preached to look after them. That's going to be very different, he says, in the days ahead. And he pictures it in terms of, you know, they're going to have to, it's going to be life-threatening sometimes. Sell your cloak, buy a sword. And they take him literally. Lord, we got two swords. And he said, that's enough. That isn't where I'm coming from. That you misunderstand me. They're so slow to learn. But he is so patient. He's careful and measured. Gives them personal on-the-job training. So different from many bosses. And he's undemanding. He says in verse 27, quite remarkably, you know, I am among you as one who serves. I'm not asking you to do anything that I don't do. What a wonderful thing it would be to have a boss who is quite willing to do all the things that you do. And perhaps you're the most menial person in the business. And you have a boss who's quite happy to do the things that you do. That's wonderful to work for somebody like that. Well, that is the Lord Jesus Christ. And he's so easily pleased. I mean, you think about what the disciples have been like in the weeks that lead up to this moment. Scratch your head with me and say, is there anything else he could commend them for but simply for hanging in there with him? But that's the thing he focuses on. You are those who stood by me in my trials. He's delighted to see, he looks to see the positive in those who belong to him. He doesn't focus on the negative. He's dealt with this question of their incredible insensitivity and their obsession with preeminence. And he's not remembering it against them. He's saying, look, you good people have stood by me in my trial. He's so easily pleased. Wonderful to work for a man like that, or a woman like that. He surely is the best of masters, and he rewards so generously. Look what he says about them. You know, this is what you've done. It's all pretty basic stuff. The trials have been his, not theirs. They've done no more than hang in there, although staying with Jesus is the very essence of being his disciple. Sticking to him, not running from him, but sticking to him. But it's not the greatest of all faithfulness, is it? It's not. He didn't talk about all the things they've done for him, because they've not. He couldn't say that. But for that very basic commitment to him, he promises astonishing rewards. Now, some of the words he uses here, verses 29 and 30, difficult to know exactly what that means. I confer on you a kingdom, just as my Father conferred one on me. That suggests at least, you know, he's not writing them off. He's going to give them responsibility beyond this world and something that will bring honor, but why does he do it? He says he does it simply for their basic faithfulness to him. And he talks about thrones. And he talks about feasting. These are blessings indeed when you think about the world to come. Unimaginable. He rewards so generously. And then the great thing about this master is, in the end, whatever you do for him, the truth is always he has done so much more for you. Why? He takes your punishment on himself. He bears hell for you, the horrors of being separated in his human experience from his heavenly Father on the cross. That's the heart of it. And then it's all the horror of being regarded as the worst of human beings and the dreadful physical punishment. To be alone and isolated in the darkness. All the evidence. Hell baying at him, the voices of hell. And he bears it all. Whatever we can do for him is as nothing compared to what he does for his own. What a master. Would you not be better off taking him and serving him totally? So we've seen that Jesus is the only rescuer. And we've seen that Jesus is the best of masters. And finally, we'll see that Jesus is the truest of friends, verses 31 to 46. See him here. He's doing all he can for his own. Follow these verses through with me. Verse 31, he warns them, Satan is after you. He prays for them. I have prayed for you, Simon. And you'll notice his confidence. He knows his prayer will be heard. They've not even seen the danger. He warns them about it. He says, I've already prayed for you. And let me encourage you to this. He will not destroy you, he says. The danger is great. But you will turn back. You will fall awfully. And he tells him what that will be. But he says, you will not fall finally. None of them will. They'll all need strength, but they will be strengthened. So he encourages them. He punctures their dangerous pride, which certainly does for Simon Peter. He won't be any good to anybody while he's an arrogant toe rag. But Christ humbles him, makes him a man who will be able to help others through this terrible experience. And then he allows them to see and hear his own struggles, verses 39 to 41, and constantly seeks to help them. He comes back. They're asleep. Wake up, lest temptation swallow you up. It's amazing when you think that of what faces him. You'd think he'd be utterly preoccupied with the horrors that face him. My friend, nothing will ever distract him from caring for his followers. So he does all he can for them. He's always straight with them. He warns them. This is the truth. Satan's after you. He warns them of their weakness. You know, if he doesn't pray for them, their faith will fail. That's how weak they are. He tells them they're all in danger, and he warns Peter. He's straight with Peter. This is what you're going to do, Peter. He warns them life is going to get much harder in this world for them and for all his followers. He warns them. There's danger that temptation will swallow them up. He warns them again. Why are you sleeping? Awake. Wake up. That's true friendship. And it's the same with all who follow him. He's straight talking. His word speaks to us. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's always straight with them. And one other thing, two things. One's not going to appear on the sheet, but on the overhead. But I think it's important. He doesn't give up on them. Jesus does not give up on them. Peter, you know, dreadful. He's going to even deny he knows Christ. He's so far from being faithful to his word. He's going to pretend he's never seen him. Doesn't know him at all. Does Christ write him off? No, he doesn't. Does he give him a long probation before he'll allow him to do anything for him again? No, he doesn't. When you've turned round, then get on with the work. Strengthen your brothers. He does not give up on them. Perhaps you find that surprising, but and it is at one level amazing, but it is immensely encouraging. And the surest proof of all that he is the truest of friends is that he seeks their company. That's what friendship is about. You know, if you're friends with somebody, you love to be in their company. How does Jesus begin? Why is he in the upper room celebrating the Passover with them? He says, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you. Not just to eat the Passover before I suffer, because it's the kind of thing which shows again what I'm doing. No, no. He said, I want to eat it with you. That matters to me. These poor followers who are always letting him down. He says, I want to eat the Passover with you before I suffer. And where does he end? He ends going back to them in Gethsemane. He's been agonizing in prayer. But his heart goes back to them. He goes back to them. He's concerned about them. He wants their company. The other gospel writers actually tell us that he says in Gethsemane, stay, come with me. He takes Peter, James and John specifically with him. Watch with me. Be with me. He seeks their company. And the ultimate thing is, of course, he wants them eternally. Did you notice the promise he makes? It's not just eating and drinking and celebrating in the world to come. It's at my table. I want you with me. And you know, an even greater promise than that is made to the worst church that the New Testament speaks about. This complacent church at Laodicea. He says, you need to repent. You've lost any semblance of love for me. You need to repent. You're not bothered about whether I meet with you in the services. You need to repent. But if you do, you will sit with me on my throne. This is Christ. He loves his people. He loves their company. He loves your company more than he loves your service. If you don't believe me, go and read the story about Martha and Mary in Luke chapter 10. So three great things about the Lord Jesus Christ. Three things that we see here. He is the only rescuer. He is the best of masters. And he is the truest of friends. No rabbits out of the hat. those things shout at you from Luke 22. So the question is, will you have him? Will you follow this one? Will he be your Lord and Saviour? And will he continue to be that? Will you cling tightly to him, whatever discouragement life may bring to you? And may bring discouragements in the business of seeking to follow him. The passage shows us the natural danger of every disciple or follower. The danger of becoming a Judas, turning our back. People do turn their back utterly on Christ and seek to stop others from following him too. Those who once professed faith like Judas. And there is a temptation that we all can become like the 11. Because there are times in life when we too are targets of the evil one, we who follow Christ. And we're always vulnerable, whatever our experiences in the past, whatever we imagine about ourselves, we are vulnerable people. Are you a Christian? If you are you conscious of your weakness, of your failure, of your dread? Don't panic. Pray. And supremely pray and remember him. Because what we see here is that he keeps. And we see actually everything that's told us about here is the righteousness that Christ, that God reckons to the account of everyone who trusts in Christ. Everywhere I've screwed up in life. And it would take me weeks and weeks to know even what I know about what I've, to tell you what I've, ways I've screwed up in life. All of it is covered by the righteousness of Christ. All of it is atoned for by his death. May God show us the beauty of his Son. May he continually show us that, that we become zealous followers of Christ. Amen. Let's sing our closing praise. I've chosen this one, Hark My Soul, It Is the Lord. William Cooper, arguably the greatest of all British ever, of British poets. He was a poet laureate for a while, a man who suffered with great bouts of depression, great darkness, but the great servant of the Lord, he wrote this lovely hymn, challenging him, but you know, how it ends is wonderful. This is a great hymn, great meditation to sing in closing. So let's sing.
Thank you. Do sit down.
Let us pray. Lord, we have seen at least a little of the wonders of your words and the glory of your Son. And we pray, Lord, that you'd open our hearts with that word. Help us to glory in him as the sacrifice for our sin, the only rescuer. Help us to glory in him who is the best of masters, and to be amazed that he is also the friend of sinners and the truest of friends. Oh, show us more of your dear Son. Help us to appreciate him. We are so slow to grasp the wonder of knowing Christ and having him as Lord and Saviour. And we pray these things that we may honour him more and live for him and live in joy and peace and hope. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
If you're watching this on catch up, that is the end of the service. Thank you for joining with us.